good evening, everyone. It's really nice to see you all turning out for our event this evening, which is Gay Straight Alliances and Religious Schools, A Clash of Rights and Freedoms. And we have two guest speakers, Dr. Chris Wells and Dr. Kent Donlevy, who's sitting at the back there. And so my name is Pat Parody. I'm the Executive Director of the Center for Constitutional Studies here in the Faculty of Law. And I'd like to begin by acknowledging the fact that the land on which we gather is Treaty 6 territory and traditional meeting ground and home for many Indigenous people, including Cree, Soto, Blackfoot, Métis, and Nakota Sioux. Now, just a little bit about the Center for Constitutional Studies. We are an important hub for constitutional research and public education here at the university, in the faculty, in our broader Edmonton community, I would say in the province, and right out to the country. And what we like to do is to provide opportunities for people to discuss controversial issues that are constitutional, and we kind of try to get you in with the controversial issue, and in the hopes that we can teach you something about the Constitution, because as you probably know, not many Canadians know a great deal about our Constitution. So we'd like to thank every single one of you for attending today and showing some enthusiasm for our event. Please do remember to sign up there's a sign-up sheet outside in the hall there as you leave. If you would like information on our events, we will send you our newsletter. And there's also apparently a little card there. There's a group of people approached me as I was entering to say that they've just started a group called We Are Human. And so they've left some cards there for you if you're interested. I hear a sound. And so I'd just like to invite you all, please, to shut your cell phones off, if you wouldn't mind. We are recording the event, and it will be available on our YouTube channel. If you sign up for our newsletter, you'll be getting a notification that it's on YouTube as soon as it's ready. So please do sign up. And you'll see evaluation sheets in front of you there. We always appreciate audience feedback, good, bad, ugly. Just let us have it, whatever you have to tell us. And anything you'd like to hear from us, please do let us know. And now I have the great pleasure to introduce our dean, Dean Paul Payton. And he has taken some time out of his very busy schedule. I have to say, I think he's triple booked this evening to come in and give some welcoming remarks on behalf of the faculty. I think this event is very important to our dean. And so we're really pleased to have you here, Paul. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Pat, and good evening, everyone. Thank you all for being here. As Pat mentioned, my name's Paul Payton. It's my privilege to serve as Dean of the Faculty of Law. And I wanted to bring some opening remarks to really emphasize the importance of the work that the Center for Constitutional Studies is doing as part of our efforts at the faculty for the public good. And as a public university, we are a public trust. And one of the missions that I've had as a dean is to make sure that our doors are open. And as part of the university community, we have a special responsibility here to foster and encourage respectful debate and dialogue about issues of public importance. And this platform and the work that the Center for Constitutional Studies does accords with the work that we're doing as an academic research institution, as a teaching institution, and as an institution that is and part of the community, to serve as a repository and a safe space for that dialogue and debate. For those of you who aren't necessarily as familiar, I want to provide a bit of context as to the special relationship between the faculty and the Center for Constitutional Studies and how we are working together to foster an environment here at the Law Center and at the university that respects inclusivity and diversity, including a diversity of perspectives. Issues of tremendous importance to me as dean and to my deanship, which is actually already halfway through the term, which is hard to believe. The faculty supports the center in a variety of different ways: physical space in the Law Center, through financial and administrative assistance and communications support, and through the intellectual contributions of our faculty members to the center's activities. But it's important that you recognize what a gem we have here. The center is a cross-Canada hub for research and public education on constitutional issues. And it works closely with our faculty members to fulfill its mandates. One example, Professors Eric Adams, Stephen Penny, Ubaka Ogbogu, Peter Sankoff, Cameron Jeffries, and tomorrow, our own Peter Carver, who is with us this evening, have given or will be giving public lectures as part of the Center's very well-received and very well-attended Downtown Charter Series. We are taking the university downtown to a public audience to foster and encourage dialogue and debate and greater understanding about the ways in which the law, and in particular the constitutional dimensions of law, have an impact on everyday citizens. The Center works closely with our faculty members and with others to showcase research on its website, through social media, and provides opportunities for academics and others to speak and organize symposia and conferences. I'm also extremely pleased of the work that they continue to do working with our students as researchers, as research assistants, in mentoring and guiding, involving our students in the work of the Center while they're here for their studies. We have the Review of Constitutional Studies, which Professor Carver is now serving as editor-in-chief for. We've got other publications. I invite you to visit the website. It's a repository of tremendous information. The other thing that it's really importantly doing is bringing people from across Canada and indeed internationally to the faculty to continue this dialogue, because issues of constitutional concern are not just for us in Canada. People are grappling with these sorts of issues worldwide. And it's a benefit to us as Albertans here in the university, here at the faculty in particular, to let our students and to let the community know that we're part of an international dialogue about these constitutional issues. I've mentioned that the Center provides opportunities for our faculty members and for our students to engage with the public through lectures and presentations, and this ties very closely into the faculty's and indeed the university's mandate to act for the public good, which incidentally is also the title of the university's new institutional strategic plan. That plan notes that as U of A community of students, faculty, staff, and alumni, we rely on shared and deeply held values that guide our behavior and our actions. Those values include, but aren't limited to, intellectual integrity, freedom of inquiry and expression, the equality and dignity of all persons as the foundation of ethical conduct in research, teaching, learning, and service, diversity, inclusivity, and equity across and among our people, campuses, and disciplines, and creativity and innovation, from the genesis of ideas through to the dissemination of knowledge. The Center helps the faculty, and indeed the university, to live up to these values. It's also important to note that the Center is nonpartisan, strictly and proudly nonpartisan, because in terms of our environment and the academic environment that is often fraught with politicization, whether small or large P, we remain importantly nonpartisan to provide that kind of venue for a discussion and mutual respect of different perspectives in these debates. Events like this evening, where the Center is bringing together two esteemed academics to discuss very topical issues for the province, but indeed for the country, serve to educate the public and to assist in the development of free thought and the exchange of ideas. In a democratic society, I'm firmly convinced universities play a critical role and continue to play a critical role for providing a venue for the open discussion of ideas and the issues of the day. Universities need to be a forum for free speech and freedom of expression where individuals can speak openly in exchange and dialogue with each other without fear of reprisal. As a nonpartisan organization, the Center helps the faculty and the university to do this in the ways that I've mentioned. And as well, those of you who are not members of the university community but are here from the public that we serve here in Edmonton and in the broader community, welcome. We are very glad that you're here. We are a resource for you and for this dialogue and debate. Before I hand the microphone back to Pat, though, I did want to talk about the support that the faculty provides for a number of our different groups, including our LGBTQ+ students. Fostering an environment of inclusivity, diversity, and equality at the Law Center has been an important part of my deanship, and I've continued to support groups from the Women's Law Forum, hosting the Women Legal Education and Action Fund, our Law Students for Inclusion and Diversity, which are very closely associated with the Federation of Asian Canadian Law Students, or the Federation of Asian Canadian Lawyers. We are home to religious groups, Christian Law Students Association, the J. Reuben Clark Law Society. These all play important roles in fostering an inclusion an environment of inclusion and diversity of thought, belief, values, and participation. The faculty also proudly supports Outlaw, which is an advocacy group which was founded in 2008 to serve and aid LGBTQ plus law students and their allies. February this year, the faculty was also very proud to participate in U Alberta Pride Week with the support from Dr. Wells, which is an important annual tradition. We partnered with the Institute for Sexual Minority Studies and Services to host an event regarding human rights advocacy for same-sex rights in the Caribbean. But one of the things that was also interesting in that respect as well was the initiative that our students themselves took. Three of our student groups, Outlaw, the Golden Barristers rugby team, and the Tortfeasers hockey team, banded together to raise money for You Can Play, which is an organization devoted to ensuring equality, respect, and safety for all athletes, regardless of sexual orientation. And they presented a $1,500 check to You Can Play as part of our Pride Week festivities. As Dr. Wells and Dr. Donlevy will discuss tonight, schools in Alberta have an obligation now to establish a gay-straight alliance for students who request one. These questions, what does this mean for religious-based schools who are objecting to this requirement? How can respect for religious freedom and protection of equality rights be balanced under Canada's constitutional framework are important legal, policy, and political ones. And so I congratulate the Centre and Pat for organizing this event. I appreciate our guest speakers for being here, and I welcome you all to what I'm sure will be a very interesting discussion. Thank you very much indeed for joining us tonight.
Well, thank you very much, Dean Payton. You said a lot of awfully nice things about our center. Thank you. And so now, without further ado, I would like to introduce our speakers. And so the format that we're going to follow tonight is as follows. We're going to begin with Dr. Wells, and he will speak for 20 minutes. Then Dr. Donlevy will speak for 20 minutes. We might give him a little bit more time, simply because he's going to be presenting religious freedom and then talking about how we manage to balance rights and freedoms that clash. So we told him we might give him a little bit of extra time, but not too much. And then we will take it back to Dr. Wells for 5 minutes for comments he may wish to make following Dr. Donlevy's talk, and then we'll give you 5 minutes as well, Dr. Donlevy, and then we'll open it up to you for questions, and I'll be giving you some short directives around the kinds of questions we hope that you will be asking. And so I will begin then by introducing Chris Wells. So Chris is an assistant professor in the Faculty of Education at the University of Alberta. He is well known in his role as the director of the Institute for Sexual Minority Studies and Services. He teaches, he teaches sexuality, gender, and culture in the Faculty of Education. He is the author of the Alberta government's new homophobic and transphobic anti-bullying and gay straight alliance resources. During his career, he's consulted with several organizations, including the Senate, the Alberta Teachers Association, the Alberta government, RCMP, and Edmonton Public Schools, among many others. And many of you may have seen Chris on television or heard of him on the radio. He's done a lot in terms of pushing the agenda in Alberta forward in terms of LGBTQ rights. And he will address, of course, the importance and the need for gay-straight alliances in schools in Alberta. And then I'm just going to introduce you as well, Dr. Donlevy, Kent, so that you can just follow Chris. So Kent is our second speaker, and he is an associate professor at the University of Calgary's Workland School of Education. His research interests include constitutional, human rights, and education law. He has lectured on religious rights and freedom of conscience at Queen's University, York University, the University of New Brunswick, and throughout the United States. He has also been a barrister and solicitor since 1985 and publishes frequently. I note that he is most recently published in the Supreme Court Law Review, proudly I see. He also published an article recently on the Trinity Western Law School issue in one of the publications that the Center puts out, which is the Forum, Constitutional Forum. That was our last 25.2, which can be found on our website. And so Kent, of course, will speak about freedom of religion, and in particular in the context of religious schools, and what the government's directive around gay straight alliances means for religious schools, and then talk about, well, how do courts manage to balance these rights and freedoms when they clash? So without further ado then, Dr. Wells.
Great. It's a pleasure to be here, and thank you, Pat, and Paul, the law school dean, for the invitation. It's always great to be able to talk about gay straight alliances and talk about issues that are happening in our province on the front lines in schools every day. And so what I've been asked to do is share a little bit about the background. So everyone knows what we're talking about, how GSAs have started, what do we see as some of the research supporting them, the impact that they have in reducing risk and building resilience of a vulnerable population, and then some of the trends. So I have a lot packed in 20 minutes. I'm going to ask Pat to give me the 2-minute warning. The slides are mostly up here to keep me on track, so we'll see how far we get. And I'm happy to share any of this information as we move forward. Perfect. Always for TV. Here we go. So when we're talking about gay straight alliances, the first question we might ask is, what's in a name? And a lot is in a name, as we'll see. But particularly the name gay straight alliances for many students in schools is already antiquated and outdated and doesn't represent the reality. So you've seen changes in terminology with queer straight alliances, where many students are embracing what they see as the fluidity of sexuality and gender. You're also seeing the name GSA being kept because of its historic and symbolic importance, but sort of repurposed to talk about gender identity and sexual orientation alliances, which firmly ground this work within our human rights context, and to provide public institutions, such as publicly funded schools, regardless of their denomination, to ensure that all students are protected and supported on the grounds of sexual orientation, gender identity, and gender expression, which recently were changes to Alberta's Human Rights Act just about this time last year. So GSAs at their core are student-centered and teacher-supported school-based groups, so they happen in school primarily. And successful GSAs are student-led. They're student initiatives where teachers come to facilitate them and support students to develop those leadership skills. So it's important we also dispel some of the stereotypes that GSAs are not dating clubs for LGBTQ youth in schools, as they're often sometimes positioned as, but they're actually safe spaces in an often hostile school environment. And we'll talk about that school environment. But GSAs are actually a fairly recent phenomenon in schools. The first one started in the United States in 1989 in a private school in Concord, Massachusetts, by a teacher named Kevin Jennings, who later went on to found the Gay, Lesbian, Straight Education Network and was one of President Obama's first appointments in the Department of Education when he was elected in 2008. I had the pleasure this summer to spend some time with Kevin Jennings, who now is the executive director of the Arcus Foundation in New York City, one of the largest granting foundations on LGBTQ issues in the world. So GSAs really started when a straight student came to Kevin, who was a gay teacher, and said, we need to do something about homophobia and discrimination in our schools. The movement has continued since then. Today, there are over 4,000 gay straight alliances in the United States. They're one of the fastest growing social movements occurring in schools across North America today. Nearly 1 in 10 high schools in the United States has a GSA, which is pretty astounding when I saw that statistic, because we often think of, you know, the United States as being much more conservative than Canada, yet this movement has much of a stronger foundation in the United States. And one of the largest reasons for that is the American Civil Liberties Union that will step in and sue any school that denies a student the right to create a GSA on behalf of that student. We don't have that same level of legal advocacy happening here in Canada. So that's one of the major drivers why GSAs have been growing so quickly in the United States. So the Canadian context, the first known GSA started in Red Deer, Alberta in 2000, which in itself is also remarkable. Many people will remember Red Deer as famously being known as the racist capital of Canada after the Keekstra situation. But the GSA started with a teacher there named Darren Lund, who is now Dr. Darren Lund at the Faculty of Education, or the, as I'm reminded, the Workland School of Education at the University of Calgary, who was a social studies teacher and who created a successful group called STOP, Students and Teachers Opposing Prejudice. And that group was protesting, for example, the abuses, the human rights abuses of Shell Oil at the corner Shell gas station across from the high school. So it was very much engaged in education, activism for social justice and human rights. And students came to Darren and said, well, what are we doing about homophobia in the classroom, in the schools? You know, if we're serious about human rights, then this is an area we really need to start a group to support students who are very vulnerable. And Darren's first response was no. Our community is not ready. I'm not ready to do this. And the students, as Darren tells the story, kept coming back to him. And finally, he said, let's do it. And to his surprise and the surprise of many, there was no backlash in the community because they had already a foundation to understand the role of GSAs as being part of extending human rights. It wasn't a special rights, wasn't a special interest group. It was a group about educating the student body and the larger community population fundamentally about human rights. So fast forward, and now today we have over 100 GSAs in Alberta. We have monthly GSA roundtables, groups that meet with GSAs from all over communities in Edmonton, Calgary, and a new one started in Lethbridge. So the idea is that they're building a larger community beyond their own school. So you could have a very successful GSA in one school, and another GSA is just starting in a new school, and they can share strategies, they can share ideas, they can build community, and they can form a coalition of support. The GSA offshoot from the roundtables was the provincial GSA conference that we helped to facilitate 5 years ago. And it was where GSAs simply wanted to continue that dialogue of sharing resources and networking and information. So we brought about 50 students and teachers from across the province together 5 years ago. I remember it very clearly. Minister Klimchuk at the time and Deputy Premier Thomas Lukaszczyk were there and talked about how history will remember what you're doing today in the same way as the famous five. Sometimes we can't see what we're in the midst of when we're talking about fundamental, monumental change in society. But when we look back, it will be these moments that we remember when society started to change. And so from that first conference 5 years ago to the one that just happened just over a week ago on November 19th to 500 students and teachers who've come together to form one of the largest student-led conferences being held in the province as part of the province's Bullying Prevention Awareness Week. In fact, it's the largest student event in the province for that week. So we start to see a movement, and this movement has crystallized into legislation. So we started just over 2 years ago with what seemed at the time a very unlikely motion. It was just sort of to test the pulse of where the legislature was, where Albertans were, when MLA Kent Hare introduced a motion, private member's motion 503, to talk about support for GSAs, and something happened when that hit the legislature floor. We saw a division in the Conservative Party where a number of MLAs stood up for the first time in the province to support LGBTQ youth and to support gay straight alliances. And so then, as the story goes, soon thereafter, Lori Blakeman, by luck or divine intervention, received a private member's bill, a slot where this could be heard, and she put Gay Straight Alliances into a basket of items to support LGBT youth in schools. And that really started a serious conversation, a movement, some may argue brought down a government, over this notion of supporting LGBTQ youth in Alberta. And lo and behold, under the Prentice government and Sandra Jansen, who was the associate minister at that time for family violence and bullying prevention, took that bill, framed their own, and we had Bill 10, which made Alberta the third province to legislate a requirement for schools to support any student who wanted to come forward and start a gay straight alliance, and importantly, name it as such. so that they couldn't be told that they have to name it something else. And we'll talk a little bit more about why that is. So there's a long story behind all of that that I've just compressed into about a minute. So I apologize to those politicians that showed that brave, committed leadership to make change. So as we're moving forward, I just want to ask this question of you to take a moment to pause and reflect upon. What is life like for LGBTQ students in our classrooms and schools today? What is life like for LGBTQ students in our classrooms and schools today? Now, if you don't know the answer to that question, or you can't answer that question, I think it says a lot. It's still an experience largely marked by silence and invisibility, or if students are allowed to be out, they're often required to fit in to the mainstream, to the heteronormative status quo, rather than change or challenge it. So research tells us, for example, that bullying based on race, ethnicity, gender, or actual or perceived sexual orientation or gender identity is associated with some of the most severe negative outcomes for students in our schools today. You know, this kind of bias-based bullying attacks the very core identity of who students are. Bias-based bullying is particularly harmful because it not only impacts individuals, but creates hostile school climates. So we have extensive research now, over 20 years of peer-reviewed, published research that talks about the risk factors or the negative outcomes that sexual and gender minority or LGBTQ plus young people often experience. So we know that they have more instances of truancy or dropping out, drug and alcohol abuse that's 2 to 3 times higher than their heterosexual peers. So you see these, what we call these negative coping mechanisms. If I just dull the pain of discrimination, I don't have to think about it. I don't have to feel it. So there's sort of avoidance of the core kinds of issues to deal with stress and stigma and shame. So we see cases of increased peer victimization, of bullying, where you withdraw from your social or your school activities because you don't feel included or that you don't belong. Interestingly, more experiences of dating violence, higher rates of pregnancy or parenting involvement. We call this sort of the paradoxical pregnancy phenomenon. You wouldn't actually think that lesbian teens, for example, have higher pregnancy rates than their heterosexual peers. But if you think about it this way, there's what greater way is there to prove one's heterosexuality than to have a child, right? To remain above question with that. So Dr. Elizabeth Sawick in the University of British Columbia has done a lot of interesting research in this area. We also know that these young people have significantly higher rates of bullying and sexual harassment or sexualized violence, particularly our trans and gender diverse youth, much higher rates of running away from home, turning to prostitution and or living on the streets, being street involved. In fact, research tells us that between 20 to 40% of all homeless or street involved youth are LGBTQ or questioning. And family rejection is the number one factor for homelessness and street involvement. And so often while we're working with LGBT youth, we can't forget that it's critically important to work with their families as well. So we know a host of mental health issues such as depression, higher rates of eating disorders, post-traumatic stress, self-harm, and increased suicide ideation or suicide attempts, which are at least 2 to 3 times higher than their peers. So we have clear evidence as to the plight, the vulnerability of LGBTQ youth, and often the hostile school environments that they find themselves in. So the question is, what are we doing to address the research before us and these experiences? So GSAs are often seen as one critical, what we call intervention and prevention site to help to reduce risk and build resilience. So the literature tells us that there are basically 4 kinds of GSAs if we want to create a kind of a typology. It's important to know that this isn't a linear process. You don't start at one stage and then evolve into the next stage. It's really about the kind of students you have, the culture of the school, the knowledge or the involvement of the teacher facilitator. So what we often tell students to do when they're thinking about creating a GSA is take the temperature of your school, assess your school climate, assess your school culture. So one type that you often see is this counseling or support group. They're low profile. They often fly under the radar. It might be a safe space sticker stuck on a door somewhere in the school, or on a classroom or an office. In these environments, it's often not safe to be visible in the school environment. So GSAs often become sort of an underground. People learn about them through word of mouth or referral, often from teachers or other students. The next kind is safe spaces. These focus more on social support. Sometimes they have official group status, but still limited visibility. I often hear from groups of students who say, well, yeah, we can have a GSA, but our school won't let us advertise the GSA. So it's still focused very much on individual support. There may be some social activities. They're kind of equated to spaces of refuge outside of those hostile hallways that they still have to encounter in their schools. So the focus here is on fitting into the mainstream. It's learning those adaptive coping mechanisms so that you can survive your school environment rather perhaps than be supported to thrive in your school environment. We often hear about policies that call for tolerance, and we'll talk more about that word tolerance and the problem with tolerance. So another kind is raising visibility and awareness. This is the more active, focused on the school climate piece, that important component. So these are often the ones that are clearly student-led. They focus on student safety, but make the connection back to human rights. Students in schools are out, they're visible, they're active. These GSAs often are engaged in a school-wide presence, so they invite guest speakers. They may be doing educational workshops for their teachers. So this is the interesting part where the students become the educators on these issues. And they actively work to challenge stereotypes and demystify LGBTQ issues. The core focus is to bring visibility. It's often been said that with visibility comes liberty, you know, the understanding that we exist, we matter in this school community. So rather than tolerance, they focus on moving to acceptance, moving to being understood as a core component of the school community. And another group is focused more on social change. This is really the social justice kind of organization that uses an anti-oppressive framework or lens. We often like to talk about they link together the isms. They talk about how heterosexism, sexism, homophobia, and privilege are all interconnected, are all about issues of power, holding power over someone else to marginalize them or make them feel inferior. So these kinds of groups often look at building coalitions. I remember interviewing a young person who started one of the first gay straight alliances in British Columbia, and they hosted what was then at the time the very first gay pride day in any high school in Canada. And he took an announcement to his school principal and said, this is going to be the most important announcement you ever read, like any grade 12 student would say to their principal. And it said simply, today at lunch, the school's GSA and the school's Christian club are coming together to plan the Pride Day. And they wanted to show the school community that they would hold hands against homophobia in their school environment, which was a very powerful statement. So the notion here is that coalitions are built. They're also connecting outward with community partners, knowing where supportive referrals and organizations and programs exist, where GSAs here in this community are seen as being valued and a visible part of school culture. This is the idea that diversity isn't hidden, but it's actively celebrated with the values of the school community. So quickly, the question becomes, why are GSAs important to schools then? What does the research tell us about the impact GSAs are making in the school environment? So we know that they work to increase a sense of safety and belonging. This is the notion that translates into individual acceptance and increased student self-esteem. I have a space, I have a place where I'm accepted, where I'm valued. I have teachers or allies that I know I can reach out to. So instead of internalizing those negative coping mechanisms or pressures, it's about externalizing and knowing there are safe people that you can reach out to help you with the issues that you may be experiencing. So we know here school connectedness is critical. It's critical to academic achievement. It's critical to improved attendance. So this notion that making strong connections with teachers is vital. Teachers are viewed as allies and trusted adults. So we know that promoting community connections plays an important role, but ultimately GSAs can help students get a sense of empowerment, not just for later, but for now, that they're learning these leadership skills, they're applying them in their school communities, and that they have a hopeful, successful future. So GSAs, as we see, help to reduce risk, build resiliency for vulnerable youth, and in fact may be a lifeline for many youth. So GSAs are most effective in schools that also focus concomitantly on staff professional development and have explicit LGBTQ policies in place. So policies are critical because they not only support the development of a GSA, but they also tell and support staff that they can be actively involved and comfortable to serve as the advisors. Because many teachers may want to support a GSA, but if they don't have policies, they may feel that their administration will not support them to be engaged in this work. And some teachers may fear for their jobs, depending on the school environment that they're actually in. So GSAs, we know, bring visibility to LGBTQ issues. They challenge hetero and gender normativity. And importantly, they normalize and legitimize LGBTQ identities. Clear policies and government legislation send a vocal and visible message of student support to LGBTQ students, staff, and families. They say, we see you, we support you, you matter. So maybe this is a good part to wrap up on, is talking about the challenge of religion. The most common objections I see to GSAs are based on two arguments. So the first argument is around parental rights, and that parents have the right to know or be notified if there is a GSA in their school or if their student attends a GSA. And so this may contradict issues of privacy, of confidentiality. There's lots of concern about students being outed in schools to their parents who may not be safe for them to reveal their identities to. In fact, parents, unfortunately, may be a big risk factor for many LGBTQ youth, as we've seen from some of the previous research. And then the second argument is the religious objections. Often we hear that there's a fear or stereotype that GSAs will promote a gay lifestyle or a particular agenda in schools. So over the past 20 years, we've seen a competition that has begun to emerge in Canada, in Canadian law, between religious-based claims versus sexual orientation or equality claims. So just this past week, we saw an example come from the courts in Manitoba with marriage commissioners. And that previously had happened in Saskatchewan, where the courts have ruled that a marriage commissioner cannot conscientiously object to performing a same-sex ceremony. In fact, because they're providing a public service. So this is always the question. If you're receiving taxpayers' funds, you're providing a public service for public benefit and public good, then we know human rights legislation and the charter apply to everything that you do. So religious-based claims are often based, interestingly, in exclusion, excluding LGBTQ issues and identities from full participation in public space, often framed as religious exceptionalism. Perhaps it would be more important to think about or ask the question, why can't religion be used to include LGBTQ youth in schools as a way to reach out, to build community, to celebrate difference, and to support those who are amongst the most vulnerable? So there's certainly much more that I can say, and hopefully I'll be able to bring that back through some of the Q&A, but I'm gonna turn it over to Kent, and thanks for your time.
This is the GSA and QSA in Alberta Schools, a guide for teachers. And I think it's appropriate to say I have a class that I have 400 students that I teach. I use this book with those students. And one of the key people who produced this book is Kristopher Wells, and I think you should give him a round of applause. Now, that being said, There are two questions that I've been asked to address today. Prior to that, however, I first thought I was coming here to speak about the law with regard to religious schools. I then discovered that it would be helpful if somebody could at least put forward the position that's often held by those people in religious schools as strongly as I possibly could, so I called some people. So what you're going to hear today is in two parts. The first part is I'm going to speak to the question, what do GSAs being used in schools today by legislation, what does it mean for religious-based schools who refuse to do so? I'm going to speak to you not about the children who clearly are at risk that Christopher spoke about. I'm going to talk to you instead about state power. State power as it works against a minority in this province, against a group that finds itself targeted by the government. Secondly, I'm going to talk to you about incommensurability, and that is the fundamental incommensurability which produces the difficulty that often people see in religious schools dealing with LGBTQ plus issues. So, let me begin. Question one, what does this mean for religious-based schools who refuse to include GSAs? Well, for private schools, for religious schools, it means anxiety and litigation. You see, the government is unlikely to back down from what it sees as a fight for the safety of an historically marginalized and bullied category of students who are in jeopardy psychologically, socially, and physically within Alberta schools. But on the other hand, parents whose children attend religious schools see the state attempting to force a particular view of being human upon them and their children. That view is manifest, they believe, in the GSA issue, because it conflicts with their strongly held religious beliefs. Such parents see the act of the government compelling the creation of GSAs as the state claiming it knows what is best for their children. Further, those parents feel that they are being told by some of us in the academy, the government, and other people in society that they know what's best for their children. These are the parents who feed, clothe, care so deeply for their children's development and safety, fail to allow their children to develop as autonomous individuals is what we're told. We're told that these parents not only fail to allow their children to develop, but also to understand the reality in the wider society. And the Supreme Court of Canada agrees with that. In the SL case out of Quebec, the Supreme Court of Canada says it's necessary for children to know more than what goes on in their own family. They have to, because they're going to be members of society. But the parents in religious society are also told that the government and other groups know best how their children should view sexuality and gender, notwithstanding that the parents, in solidarity with their religious communities, have been caring for their children quite well, thank you very much, for generations. Some feel as if they've been told that without government intervention into how their children view sexuality and gender, their children may become cruel homophobes, bigots, or wounded members of the LGBTQ community, or indifferent to the plight of their fellow citizens who have been marginalized, persecuted, and bullied. To those parents, to these parents in religious schools, and for some in public schools, this smacks of the benevolent government knowing better than parents how to raise their own children. A return to the mentality of the residential schools, government knowing best, and the power of the state cannot be resisted without penalty. Some in religious schools see GSAs as the thin edge of the wedge of government power, telling them that their freedom of religion and freedom of conscience and perhaps even freedom of association must be all subject to the view of human sexuality and gender, which demands respect and inclusion as defined by the government. Religious schools are required to accept these definitions. Yet, religious schools have respect for all and seek inclusion within their religious schools' faith communities. These terms are defined within the faith community based upon their religious beliefs. Parents believe that they must accept the government's understanding of those terms, which is not based upon a theological understanding of what it is to be human and the meaning of sexuality. But all religious schools have to do is deny their theologically based views of sexuality, in essence, agreeing with the government that religious truths are false or not significant. And all will be well, and the money will continue to flow. The consequences to the religious schools of such a denial of belief is the loss of the raison d'etre of the religious school to teach their children the word and behavioral expectations of their deity, to lead their children to what they believe is salvation, to authorize the normalization and the acceptance of beliefs which are contrary to their faith in the schools, is to teach their children that their faith is not true, and thus puts their children's salvation in jeopardy within the very institution which in which they are to evangelize their children to bring them to salvation within the faith community. What is at issue for many parents is not just their faith, but the spiritual welfare of their children. For parents in religious schools, a rejection of the theological view of being human in concert with what they believe to be God's will, as those parents see it, is anathema. Some religious parents see the institution, pardon me, the situation, as the state demanding that they, in effect, publicly reject their religious beliefs by giving their children up to school-wide activities, such as school-wide gay pride activities and guest school lecturers, promoting the normalization of views of sexuality which are not consistent with the school's faith community's beliefs. The feeling of many parents in religious schools is that, like that of St. Thomas More, they are being told by the state that they may not stay silent on an important state issue, and that they must endorse a particular law which impinges upon their conscience and their religion and puts their children's eternal salvation at risk, as they're being told that a belief in the normalization of a view of sexuality which is seen as religiously challenging is to be seen with pride and endorsed as a reasonable choice of lifestyle. Indeed, this goes further than the choice given to St. Thomas More himself, because not only must parents accept and support that which is anathema to their faith, they are being forced by the state, I say forced by the state, to actively support and participate and offer up their children to this view. In other words, St. Thomas More must not only state that the marriage to Anne Boleyn is lawful, but that the state demands that he must also perform the ceremony. GSAs are not about, quote, not about discussing or describing sexual activities. They're not about sex dating clubs, nor an official endorsement of homosexuality, nor are they only for LGBTQ students, nor are they anti-faith or anti-religious. So says this booklet, which I referred and I use in my school, my university classes, on page 17 and 21, which is the ATA guide. However, they normalize views of sexuality which are not in concert with certain religious beliefs within the school, the religious school, and ostensibly seek to engender pride in a view of sexual orientation which is deemed to be, by the religious belief, disordered and producing behaviors which are to be resisted. That is very difficult for anyone in modern day societies to even mouth, because by itself it seems tremendously homophobic, tremendously hurtful, and ignorant and stupid. Let me continue. It is that simple, however, in the view of religious schools. Thus, religious parents are labeled as, are you ready, homophobes. Well, the government ministers are seen as crypto-fascists. This is a terrible state of affairs for fear-mongering and name-calling, preventing any reasonable, respectful dialogue, and thus precluding a resolution or even a modus vivendi of this socio-political impasse. Those on both sides of the issue remain wounded, insulted, angry, and claiming to have the best interest of the children in religious schools in mind. One side, based upon philosophical and psychological beliefs and evidence, is sincere in that it is seeking security, acceptance, and respect of all children in all schools, and a chance for the years of marginalization and oppression, which no one doubts, no one challenges, to be finally overcome. These clearly must be seen as laudable goals. On the other side, the parents of those children, that is, those who change the diapers, get up at 2 a.m. to warm the bottles of baby's milk, get up every morning and go to work to put food on the table for their children, cry with them when they're hurt on the playground, stay up late at night when they have a cold, bake the birthday cakes, drive them to school and care for them on a daily basis through their infancy and through their adolescence. These are the ones that our state says can't be trusted to protect those children in religious schools. As Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau said, the state has no business in the bedrooms of the nation. I agree. Parents in religious schools say the state has no business in the temple, in the synagogue, in the mosque, or the church, nor in any schools on matters of religious conscience and belief. The very reason the schools were created by their faith communities, through which caring and loving parents seek to teach the truth of their God and assist in the securing of their children's salvation. This, then, is the social political conundrum. This is the impasse between Athens and Jerusalem. It's likely to be up to the courts. We're now into part two. It's a little calmer. It will likely be up to the courts to act as Solomon to resolve the issue between the government and the parents and religious schools. That leads us to ask this question. How might the courts balance the interests at issue? How can the respect for religious freedom and protection of equality rights be balanced under Canada's constitutional framework? Religious schools such as those in the Calgary Islamic School or Fort McMurray Islamic School, which are governed as alternative schools under public districts and are mandated to allow a gay-straight alliance club if requested, exist. To date, there have been no requests, although I've been told that there's some concern among the parents of those. This is one category of religious schools in our province. Here's a second category of religious schools in our province, not associated, attached to the public school system. And these are the private religious schools, such as those run by the Independent Baptist Christian Education Society in Alberta. And, of course, the third category of the Catholic separate schools, which are constitutionally protected. I've not the time to go through the laws that applies to each category, and it differs certainly between the first two categories and the Catholic separate schools. I'll deal with the broader charter issues in a moment. But before I do that, I must answer a question. Why won't we deal with the provincial human rights legislation? Well, my position is that a complaint brought by a person alleging a breach of the Alberta Human Rights Act would certainly resonate in the forum, but it would also end up likely in judicial review at the Court of Queen's Bench, and it is as a complement, as a complainant would encounter charter defenses. The legal intricacies of that discussion, then, I will leave to another day. Let me return to the charter. For my purpose today, I suggest that the courts will be asked to balance a religious school's right to freedom of conscience and religion, and perhaps association, with a student's right under Section 15, the equality provision. You're not to be discriminated against if you're in a certain category. In this case, it's sexual orientation. And likely also under Section 7, which is the security of the person. We know that LGBTQ students in schools are targeted. We know that they are bullied. We know that the rate of suicide is higher than it is for any other group. We're talking about security of the person. Surely those students should be able to say, we should have a GSA in our school because it's a matter of security of the person. Freedom of religion, in the case of Catholic separate schools. Freedom of religion? Yes, because in the Catholic faith, there is a particular way that conscience may actually trump the magisterium. I've talked about that before. It's an interesting point which some of my friends in the Catholic school system say, do we really have to talk about that? And freedom of expression under 2B. This is a complex analytical task for the Queen's Bench Justice, for sure. Well, we can't examine each of these sections today, but balancing one within one will serve as a template in general, I think, a description of the balancing processes used by the court in such cases. Indeed, the courts have provided this mechanism to balance the government's ability to achieve its goals, the protection of LGBTQ plus students, and also to protect individual rights, the individual rights of freedom and religion. This balancing test is now considered a cornerstone of Canadian constitutional law. Lawyers will know of it as the revised Oakes test. Pat says I wasn't supposed to say that. Sorry, Pat. Okay, I didn't say it. Forget it. But before we look at this test, I have to ask a few questions. Here's one. Is the right to freedom of conscience of religion engaged by the Alberta government? I mean, is that right even engaged, compelling religious schools to accept GSAs? I suggest to you the answer is yes, as GSA's general position on human sexuality in general is in conflict with that of some religious schools. Therefore, it is engaged. Secondly, one of the leading cases in Canada that deals with what is freedom of religion is a case out of Quebec. I call it the Anselm case. And basically, here's what the court said. Mr. Justice Yakubuki, speaking for the majority, said, at the first stage of religious freedom analysis, and that's what we're talking about, religious freedom, an individual advancing an issue premised upon a freedom of religious claim must show the court, number one, that he or she has a practice or belief having a nexus with religion. Done. What I've said earlier. Which calls on a particular line of conduct. So, check that. Secondly, he or she is sincere in his or her belief. I don't think there's any doubt whether we believe, whether we agree with the people in certain religious schools or not, that they're certainly sincere. They may be wrong, they may be antiquated, and the result of what they're doing may be really hurtful to people, particularly children. I'm thinking of a young child. When I was teaching in elementary school, someone said to me, what does it mean if you're an LGBTQ student? I said, well, imagine if you've got, because my little kids, my daughters did not tell my wife and I divorced when they were in grade 3. They didn't tell the rest of the school until grade 6 because they were shamed. And I think, well, how much more shame would it be if in kindergarten you can't bring both your dads or both your moms to the classroom because you're ashamed. I mean, also, well, I used to play football, and I can imagine walking into a school, and you know how they have all those wonderful trophies up behind the glass? And I was thinking, if I was an LGBTQ student and I walked into a school and I looked in the glass, the funny thing was I couldn't see my reflection in the glass. I wouldn't be able to see my reflection in the glass. And that's got to tear your heart out. So, nevertheless, these are sincere beliefs held by these schools. The second question I would ask is that right held by the institution or community or an aggregate? And by the way, in Canada today, because of a case called Loyola, we don't know if these institutions have the right of freedom or religion. The individuals in them do. However, the Loyola case says we think the aggregate of them have a corollary right which will attach to the institution. It's tricky. It's tricky. But nevertheless, leaving that aside. In fact, the idea is we think it has, whether or not there's been a breach. Does this breach this Section 2A right? GSA's in a school. Not allowing them in my school. Where is the problem here? Where's the breach? Well, I'm saying this. Seeking to have a safe space for the inclusion and welcoming of students does not in itself breach the rights of parents or staff in religious schools. Let me say it again. Seeking to have a safe space for the inclusion and welcoming of students does not in itself breach the rights of parents or staff in religious schools. However, the argument will not be that the protection and safety of LGBTQ students is at issue, because who could argue with that? I mean, I can't imagine, no reasonable person. I mean, you have to be worse than a Philistine. You'd have to be a sadist to argue with that point. Rather, it is the acceptance of difference with regard to the acceptance of sexual orientations and sexual activities within those orientations which are contrary to the faith. Also contested will be the political activities, and this is taken from page 31 of the book that I mentioned to you before, within the school, and the desire to involve, quote, school-wide educational activities and programs through guest speakers, assemblies, Pride Week activities, end of quote, all of which support the acceptance of sexual orientation which is deemed religiously disordered by the school's faith community. The argument will be that bullying will not be tolerated in the school, but neither will the covert challenge to religious beliefs and principles, which are the raison d'etre for the existence of the school itself. Such a vigorous agenda for GSAs within religious schools, all with the intention of reducing bullying and improving school safety and acceptance of difference, when tied to, their words in that book, not mine, political activities, assemblies, guest speakers, and seeking to, quote, develop a variety of strategic tools to educate the entire school, the entire community, end of quote, presumably in support of accepting a particular view of sexuality and gender, goes far beyond merely protecting students at risk. The argument of the religious school will be that no group in society should have the use of state power to force children in religious faith communities to participate in activities which fundamentally challenge the very reason and the existence of the religious school. Again, it is not the presence of a GSA as an anti-bullying club that will be the issue. That won't be the issue. Nobody can argue with that. Rather, at issue will be the operationalization of its activities, which support the normalization of beliefs about sexual and gender identity that are anathema to a religious faith community. The incommensurate positions, let's crystallize it. The incommensurate positions crystallize when, if GSAs are operational with inside religious schools, and this part is going to kill you, but LGBT students will be told that their sexual orientations are disordered, and hence the teachers can guide them in the correct religious approach to live with the disorder. So that will be seen by some as doing the very, very, very thing GSAs are intended to ameliorate: discrimination, homophobia in school, and damage to children. The only resolution would be to demand that religious schools no longer teach their religious beliefs on sexuality and gender to students in their schools. As to continue to teach those beliefs is disrespectful, hurtful, and produces psychological damage to students. Surely this is the logical conclusion of having GSAs in a religious school in the end. Moving to the test. Is the government's goal pressing and substantial? That is it important and necessary? This is what the court's going to ask. Clearly the safety of students is important, and it is necessary. And the statistics showing the horrendous effects upon LGBTQ plus students due to bullying and marginalization in school, without a doubt, is pressing. The statute itself, by the way, provides the necessary according to law piece, which this particular section of the charter requires. Let's move to the second part of this test that the court's going to look at. It asks three questions. First of all, is the law, the GSA law, rationally connected to its purpose, the protection? If it's arbitrary or serves no logical purpose, then it will not meet the standard and GSAs will not be forced on schools. For this matter, the onus is on the state to establish a rational connection. Clearly, a law which allows students to demand a GSA club, which has at its purpose the reduction of bullying and improving student safety and acceptance of differences, is, I suggest, is rationally connected to the objective of achieving safe, respectful places for members of the LGBTQ plus community in schools. So I suggest that part of the test is certainly met. Secondly, does the law minimally impair the charter right? A law which does more than minimally impair a charter right will not stand as being constitutional. The law must minimally impair or is within a range of reasonably supported alternatives. Herein lies the first rub, the first problem. Religious schools say that a GSA with its attendant social, educational, and political activities and its school-wide programs with guest speakers, presumably representing a particular lifestyle which is contrary to the beliefs of the religious school and Pride Week celebrations, goes beyond the mere amelioration of bullying into an attempt to normalize beliefs, which they cannot accept. On the other hand, Justice Laforet in Eldridge and British Columbia, it's a Supreme Court of Canada case from 1997, noted that, quote, and this is important, it's an important argument to use, and it's one that most people that I've spoken to in religious schools, they have no idea. It says this, disadvantaged groups, LGBTQ communities, require special treatment above what normal groups require, because Section 15 instantiates a desire to rectify and prevent discrimination against particular groups suffering social, political, and legal disadvantage in our society. So there's good reason to do more for this particular group of students than one would do for other students. It should be a different kind of club because of the history, because of the damage. So more than merely addressing bullying may be found by the courts to be acceptable and necessary to address the LGBTQ plus students' challenges within the school. And arguably, although the GSA actions may go beyond the minimum to protect bullying, it nevertheless will meet this particular section and be approved by the court. Finally, the final part of the test that the court will look at to balance the rights. The law, even if it is rationally connected to the purpose and minimally impairs the charter right, it will fail to be constitutional unless its effect on the charter right is not disproportionate to achieving the law's purpose. That is the effect too high to pay for seeking to achieve the law's purpose? Here again, that's a key issue, which the government must meet for its legislation to stand. Religious schools must argue that the effect of having a GSA in their school, with its actions flying in the face of their religious beliefs, normalizing a view of sexuality and gender which puts at risk the truths of their faith and the acceptance of those most vulnerable, their children, is anathema. Religious schools would argue that the presence of GSA adversely affects the family, the belief systems of children, puts at risk children's salvation in their faith, as it attempts to normalize and to show pride in a particular aspect of sexuality which they cannot accept. And they would argue that this is too high a price to pay to stop bullying, which can be done by other means. The attendant social, educational, and political activities of GSAs, so they would argue, would go too far to deleteriously affecting the faith communities in the school, and therefore, so it would be argued by those people who support religious schools, is that it is in the last section that the argument of having GSAs in religious schools would fail. In sum, it is difficult to know how the courts may hold in a case with private religious schools challenging the law with regard to GSAs. It may be instructive to note the recent Loyola decision has upheld the right of a religious school in Quebec to teach from a religious point of view in a secular curriculum, at least in part. Also relevant is the recent British Columbia Court of Appeal case dealing with Trinity Western Law School, where the unanimous Court of Appeal in British Columbia strongly supported the view of differing views in society and said the following at paragraph 193, quote, this is the very last paragraph in that decision. A society that does not admit of and accommodate differences cannot be a free and democratic society, one in which its citizens are free to think, to disagree, to debate, and to challenge the accepted view without fear of reprisal. This case demonstrates that a well-intentioned majority, acting in the name of tolerance and liberalism, can, if unchecked, impose its views on the minority in a manner that is in itself illiberal and intolerant. How am I doing for time? I'm done, in many ways. I'm coming to the lion's den. All right. This may be grist for the argument, but when GSAs become involved with educational and political activities and seek to develop a variety of strategic tools to educate the entire school community, such becomes activities of persuasion. For views anathema to the faith community of the school, that would be arguably a bridge too far for Section 15, and thus, I suggest to you, the legislation would fail. Thank you. I won't go on for the rest.
Great. And thank you for that wonderful thought-provoking analysis. I would pick up by saying, from my perspective, we're not talking about persuasion, but we're talking about human rights and living out and acting and following human rights in our schools. We know also that successful GSAs do exist in Catholic schools. So perhaps it's a matter of leadership and the interpretation of faith that may be a barrier for some schools of religious background to actually support a GSA. I think it's also important to know that GSAs are non-curricular. They're not happening in classrooms. They're voluntary, so no one is forced to go. And what they do is they attempt to normalize human rights obligations to provide a discrimination-free environment. Some limited research that's starting to emerge, looking at gay-straight alliances that are in Catholic schools, this is also an area where research needs to continue to grow. Partly, a challenge has been getting access into those schools that have GSAs, because if there are GSAs in Catholic schools, often they're hidden away, no one wants to talk about them publicly, and just the students in that school community might be able to access them. So it does leave us with a little bit of a research gap, but there is some promising research that has pointed out a number of issues. I think first and foremost is the question or the statement that with public funding comes public responsibility. To maintain legitimacy as a publicly funded institution, religiously based schools must follow the law, they must follow the legislation, and they must follow educational policy. Religion should or can be used as grounds for inclusion, not exclusion. I think we need to work on and think about how do we prioritize the needs of LGBTQ youth with all of those attendant risk factors and vulnerability we've been talking about over these acrimonious debates. The more we get bogged down in debates, the more students are at risk in their schools every day. And it's been clear that for many, GSAs can be a lifeline. They can and do save lives. So the question is really, what are we going to be prioritizing? And I think in education, it really comes down to prioritizing students and safety first. For all educators, safety is the number one obligation that we have. And lastly, I think what we need to do is focus on unifying religious values, or the unification of religious values of inclusivity, love, and support. How do we go about finding common ground? And I think moving and focusing forward on student safety is the common ground that we need to come together with. No one is arguing for the elimination of funding to religiously based schools. In fact, we know religion can play a very important role in our society and in the lives of young people. I think what we're talking about is the interpretation of religion as it gets played out when we're talking about issues of LGBT identities, realities, and how they're manifested in GSAs. You know, it's remarkable to think about how far Alberta has come as a province in a very short period of time. We have gone from being the most regressive province in the country on LGBTQ issues to now being seen as one of the most progressive, if not the leader in Canada on LGBTQ issues. It's perhaps no small statement that the Prime Minister has chosen Randy Boissonneau from Edmonton Centre, an out gay man living in Alberta, as his special advisor on LGBTQ issues. And it's because of what's happening here in Alberta and the changes and the lessons that can be learned that can be translated all across this country. So I think we have a lot to be proud of as citizens of this province. And it's not the government, but it's what the citizens demand of the government. So I'll stop there, and I know I think Pat's going to open for questions.
Actually, no, she's
going to
give me a minute.
Okay, you get a minute. We'll get in this response loop.
Very briefly. Let me reiterate again. First of all, the law is not settled. The law is continually evolving. Anyone who challenges the law is not necessarily doing something illegal. In fact, it's exactly what the law is intended to do, to be a vigorous debate on major issues of policy. The other point is this. It truly is perceived by the perception of a lot of people is in the religious communities is this is an issue of power. That is, a majority of people and in government using legislation to tell them what's going to do with their children, and they have the responsibility on a daily basis to deal with their children. So to merely say this is not necessarily a matter of power is false. Yes, the other point is this. There is, and this is a fundamental issue which has never been talked about in these kind of forums before. This is an incommensurable dissonance. There are religious people in this country, in communities, who believe that the beliefs that we are all the same, that it doesn't matter what sexual orientation you have, it doesn't matter. There are people in our society who say it does matter. It does matter because if you practice that particular kind of sexual orientation, you are going to suffer. If I practice it and I'm a believer in that religion, then I'm going to suffer for it spiritually. It's an incommensurate position. The issue is, therefore, not to paper over these things, but to sit down with people and honestly talk to them. You can say to them they're stupid, they're ignorant, they don't know what they're talking about, and not all of them agree with what they're saying, but the fact is the issue is there. How do we live together is the issue. It's not who has the power today to get the government to do something, so get my position into it. Prior to 1968, if you were a homosexual and you committed a homosexual act, you went to prison under the criminal code. The power was in the hands of people at that day by the state. Now the power may be in the hands of other people who say that particular things that religious schools don't want in the school are going to have. Is this just a power game? No, I hope not. This can't be about power. It has to be about us sitting down together and trying to respect each other, carving out pieces in society where we can be with the community of believers we have, without someone coming in and saying, you're going to have to believe this, or you're going to have to live like this, or you're not going to get any funding. Oh, really? I pay taxes too. It's a major issue, folks, and it's not an easy issue. There's crying, there's hurt on all sides, and so I would suggest to you this. Sometimes Dickens is right. The law's an ass. This should not be a legal question. This should be a question of honest men and women sitting down, pouring out their hearts and working through it in goodwill, not forcing other people to do anything, whether they happen to be in any community. I'm done.
So we will very happily open this forum now to questions, but I note that we are very, very short of time. I think we started late and then just the time has gotten away from us. So what I'd like to do with your agreement is go for an extra 10 minutes to say 6:40, or 6:40, 20 to 7. And does anyone have a serious problem with that additional 10 minutes added? That will give those of you who want to ask questions an opportunity to do so. It's not a whole heck of a lot of time to add, but at least to some of you who may be wanting to ask questions will have that opportunity. So just by way of questions then, we have a microphone over there and a microphone over there. So if you'd like to ask a question, could you please go to the mic? If you're not able to get up, we'll take the mic to you. Just raise your hand and we'll do that for you. I would like to encourage those of you who want to ask questions to please keep your questions short. We had a moderator here once, Paula Simons, who said, you know, you're all adults here. You know the difference between a speech and a question? We've had two speeches. We've actually invited our speakers here. We don't want you making a speech. So would you please just keep it to the questions? So I will just defer to Paula Simons on that and say, if you could sort of follow along her suggestion, we would appreciate it. It also gives more people an opportunity to ask questions, which is a more democratic thing to do. So the floor is open to questions, if any of you have them, and maybe you won't. Go ahead.
My question is directed to Dr. Chris Wells. You made a statement religion should and can be used as grounds for inclusion and not exclusion. Are you not at that point telling me or telling somebody of a religious belief what they are to believe and what they're not to believe?
I think my belief is focused not on the individual religious beliefs, but on the public obligations of religiously funded institutions. So that's where I would draw the distinction. And certainly talking about the fact that many Catholic schools that have GSAs are using religion as a grounds for this work, for reaching out, for being there for the vulnerable who need support, rather than it being seen as a mechanism just to simply exclude. And I think it's critically important that we are engaging in those discussions, that they don't turn into, as was suggested, polarized kinds of debates, because we've seen that. We've seen that in a recent election that won't be named, of what happens when you get to this extreme kind of polarization where debate actually breaks down and we don't actually hear each other. For me, this is all about putting the lives and of young people first. And when we work with those young people, the message I have for them is, you're normal, you're beautiful just the way you are, you don't need to change, it's society that needs to change. And I say that unapologetically, because for too long, they've been told that there's something wrong with them, or that they're disordered, or that they're evil, or that they're immoral, right? And this gets into that contestation. And I believe when we're in a publicly funded school, there are set obligations that we have to abide by. And it's interesting to know some new research that's come looking at the experiences of teachers around LGBTQ issues. A study just came out called the Every Teacher Project that shows 85% of educators support LGBTQ inclusive education, and including 83% of Catholic educators. So this is not a problem for the teachers. This is often a problem for outside interest groups, legislators, often politicians, institutions. When it comes down to supporting kids in schools, teachers have got it right.
Sure. Actually, my expertise is in Catholic education, as is my dissertation. So let's be clear. The Catholic Church is not a democratic institution. Secondly, have you ladies noticed that? Secondly, it tends to be a sexist organization because it's all men. The other thing as well is this, that it is nevertheless, I'm aware of the fact with several bishops that I've spoken to, is why do you think that was not, this DSAs weren't challenged in Ontario? Because of the possibility of losing a constitutional battle, and it's extremely expensive. Not because they didn't think it was worthwhile, but because of the expenditures. Do you think the bishops in Western Canada haven't talked about this? Do you think they haven't gotten together, the Catholic bishops, and talked about it? Really, they get together often. Do you think for a moment that they have made a decision, that they haven't made a decision not to fight this publicly constitutionally, which they may very well could have done, and it may have been successful. That hasn't been decided. That's not certain. Right? That they've decided that they will allow GSAs in the school. But nevertheless, it may be a question of the operationalization, which is what I say. At that point, it may very well be when the rubber hits the road. But one certainly cannot say for a moment that the magisterium of the Catholic Church approves sexual orientation. It says specifically what it says about disorder. Now, we can disagree with it as much as you like. We can say that it's wrong, but it is nevertheless within the church itself. The fact that some people in the church don't agree with it, that's normal. You've got a billion people. Not everybody's going to agree. And to say we only care about the children, that's the only thing we should think about, no. We have more to think about. We have human rights, that is, a human right, the right to freedom of religion, the right to freedom of conscience, the right to freedom of thought, the right to freedom of association. One is not more important than the other. Remember, we balance. We balance in this country. And it's in that balance that the devil's in the details. It's not an easy decision.
I'm going to go here, and then we'll.
Thank you very much. I work for a public school board here in Alberta, and I'm having trouble framing the question because we're dealing with an emerging issue right now where we do have a funded school in the district that is an alternative Christian program, and they have decided to allow the formation of a GSA group, but the principal has reserved the right to appoint who the staff liaison for that group will be. And of course, there are all kinds of implications there. If they appoint someone that the students are not comfortable with, it essentially kills the potential for the formation of a group. So as we deal with this emerging issue, and either one of you or both of you could answer this, I guess my question has to do with what would be the legal implications of this. Does the principal have the legal right to appoint that person, and what policy implications and ethical implications of those kinds of decisions? Big, I know, but.
Yeah, we've seen that put into policies of some school districts as well. And so, as you've already identified, if the students don't feel that their advisor is supporting them or the advisor is a barrier, they're not going to go. And the question is, will those students be motivated then, as the Minister of Education in Alberta has said, if you're not being supported in your school, to call me directly? And with that question will be, will the minister intervene? Will the Alberta Teachers Association intervene? All principals in Alberta are members of the Alberta Teachers Association. Therefore, they also have to uphold the policies, the codes of conduct of their profession. So they could potentially, if they were found to be discriminatory in any way, subject to a complaint of professional misconduct. But we would hope that that person who was appointed would be actively listening to these youth and want to help these youth find the support that they need. That's really where I trust and put my faith in teachers as professionals to do the right thing or know who to contact to support them, to put the best interests of those students first and foremost over everything else.
Just a quick addition. The answer to your question is, yes, it is. Yes, you can do it legally. Secondly, not all teachers in Alberta are members of the Alberta Teachers Association. They don't have to be. There are exceptions to that, for example, in charter schools. The third thing is, if a principal decides or a school board decides they're going to have a GSA in the school, then my personal opinion would be they are ethically bound to do everything in their power to ensure that the person who's appointed the teacher is going to do everything in his or her power to help those students, particularly in that club. Ethically bound. And if they aren't, then I would report that person into the ATA. And there's a methodology. Anybody can report anybody to the ATA, a teacher to the ATA. That's what I would do.
Thank you very much. Religious freedom is very important. I think we can all agree on that. But
is it yours, Chris?
I can believe anything I want. I can have any religion I want, but I cannot inflict my religion on others. I might believe in human sacrifice because it's part of my religion, but I cannot conduct a human sacrifice because that's simply wrong. All right. So simply having a religious belief is fine. You can believe whatever you want, but you cannot inflict it on others. You cannot inflict it on publicly supported schools in particular. That's my point. Thank you.
Actually, it's not correct. That is, religious beliefs in schools being required. That is not correct. Constitutionally, in Canada, in Alberta, in Saskatchewan, and in Ontario, Catholic schools have a constitutional right, for example, in Alberta, to, under Section 17 of the Alberta Act, to actually teach religion in the school, the Catholic religion in the school. And furthermore, to hire Catholic teachers. And furthermore, if someone does not abide by the morals of the Catholic Church, can be fired. So your point, though I understand it, is to say there's a certain amount of outrage to say anybody should be able to inflict beliefs on someone else. Some people have said the existence of Catholic schools is an anomaly. Initially, it was there. It was established in Upper and Lower Canada to protect minorities in Ontario with respect to French Canadians, and in Lower Canada or in Quebec with respect to English-speaking Canadians. It dealt with religion, it dealt with education, it dealt with culture, it dealt with language. Surely we no longer deal with culture or language, and therefore, if it's only religion, should it still exist? Some people say it's an anomaly. I leave that aside. Newfoundland agrees with that, and apparently as well so does Quebec. Nevertheless, it exists, at least in those three provinces, constitutionally protected.
Dr. Donlevy, in your description of the different arguments, you sort of described this as a clash of powers and of parents knowing best versus government knowing best. For me, Bill 10 and the law surrounding GSAs always stood more for the premise that occasionally students know best. And students know best. And I bring that up because to me, Bill 10 empowered students, their own freedom of association that was being blocked by certain school boards. So described that way, it actually facilitates the very discussion that all of us have sort of called for tonight, to allow these issues that exist within faiths about what does sexuality mean, what's the obligation for people that are sexual minorities, how do you deal with those people? And GSAs can facilitate that discussion. So I'd welcome your comments.
GSAs facilitate the discussion as to the nature of sexuality, and also the fact that the old expression is God doesn't make junk, for heaven's sake. Human beings are human beings. Absolutely, I understand that point of view. However, one of the difficulties with, as it was Bill 10, is this, is that, yes, student voice is critically important, particularly in junior high and high school, because your children are learning to become citizens in a democracy, for heaven's sake, right? But the issue is whether or not they should have that right to demand a club in a school. My own personal opinion on that, if you're out of your own interest, is if a student believes that if I'm an LGBTQ student, I should have the right to do that. And if just as I can form any other kind of club, although this one is very special because it deals with the innate nature of who I am, right? For example, I mean, if I'm going up there and I say I want an Afro-American club, Afro-Canadian club, they're going to say no, uh-uh. Then what's the distinction between that and I want an LGBT club? What's the distinction? You know, I want to get together with people who are the same as I am. They're human beings. We have the same thoughts. Or maybe we're just questioning. So I think it should be done. But I just have difficulty when any student, because I've been a principal, right, is have students come up to me and say, I want a club. Although I understand the understanding behind it. And I understand student voice being important. And I'm probably off your question. I apologize.
First of all, thank you to both of you for your presentations and from the impassioned point of view to talk about a marginalized community. I just really commend all your efforts. And especially I like the context of really working together towards things. So here's the tough question though, is that when we talk about the LGBTQ community educating, what about the reverse? What about the spiritual communities or the faith-based communities? I haven't heard anything about being open to their education of you and looking at evidence from those group, which I did a bit of research before this, and they're saying, hey, there is a lot of stuff that's going on that's positive and that's helpful and that's esteeming for individuals who may be of a different orientation. I'd like your comment on that.
Yeah, I think part of the argument to that would be that these youth are steeped in that education all the time. And particularly within those faith-based school environments, right? It's often commented that religion and faith permeate everything that we do, and a GSA provides an alternative to other ways of understanding sexual orientation and gender identity. So this is often where we get into some of these challenges. I absolutely agree about dialogue, but part of it is where do you draw the line when somebody says you're disordered? Exactly. Versus I'm fine just the way I am. And I think that's sometimes where the rhetoric gets heated, and no one has the right to call me disordered, or if I don't ascribe to that particular religious viewpoint or that particular interpretation. We know that there is not one definitive interpretation of religion or of faith, but there are many. Sometimes I think we get into the challenge in religiously funded schools that there is only one, right? And that this is church power coming up against state power. And part of the question was, we've seen this happen in school boards with duly elected public trustees of Catholic school boards. If they're not the ones making the decision, and somebody else, a bishop who's unelected, is actually making the decisions, well then why do we even elect trustees? Let's just be very clear and honest how decisions are being made. So maybe we're going down a different discussion with that, but absolutely, I think respectful education needs to happen, but I think it breaks down when arguments come in and say there's something intrinsically wrong or disordered with you. I don't think that opens up conversation. I think it really closes it down. And it makes young people that I've dealt with who say, I go to bed every night and I pray to God that he will change me, and it doesn't happen. There must be something fundamentally wrong with me. And we see the result of that is suicide is kids who run away from their families, who are cast out of their families, who are alienated from their families, who are subjected to conversion or reparative therapy that is completely unethical, to try to change these kids because they're fixed or broken, rather than seeing them as the gift and the wholeness that they are.
Chris is absolutely right about all those points, except this.
There's always one.
Always. You want me to talk into a mic? Here's the difficulty. If you're looking at a body, a community from outside the community, you can point to all sorts of things in the community. And you can say, that's not what's meant. Well, let me be very clear. And this isn't applied to Catholic community. I mean, I've got, you know, I've talked to people in the Islamic community, I've talked to people in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, I've talked to people in the Baptist community. All of these people have certain beliefs. And it's not up to me, if I'm not in their community, to say to them, you're wrong. Your religious beliefs are wrong. And if they religiously believe that, yes, you are disordered if this is there, you can say, you're crazy. You're causing all sorts of damage. But guess what? It's Canada. They have a right to free speech. You can say, you're hurting your children. Really? They take them to school. They feed them. They've raised them all their life. And you're going to now step in and say, you're wrong. Not only are you going to say you're wrong, but I'm going to get the government to come in and do something. Well, why don't we go to the next actual step, which is what, as they say, happened in London, England, where a Christian couple who had had adopted children over a number of years, they'd done a wonderful job, came to, the children had all grown up, they'd gone to adopt another child. And the adoption agency in London, England said, you can't adopt. And they said, why? They said, because you're Christian. I said, what? You're fundamentalist Christian, and you're homophobic, I should say. And as a result, what about if the child you adopt ends up by being a homosexual? We can't take that chance. So we're not going to give you the right to adopt. Well, look, if we really feel that way, either let these people be in their community to live their life according to their own beliefs, or do you really want to get the government to come in and they'll do the dirty work for you? They'll do the dirty work. In Canada, we are communities of people who have differing beliefs. We've got Hare Krishnas, we've got secularists, we've got Catholics, we've got all sorts of groups. Let them be and help them. Talk with them, sit down with them. Don't use the power of the government to go in and say, I'm going to take your children. We did that once before in residential schools because the government knows the best. And the best, you know, the road to hell is paved with good intentions. Let's all help the children. I know about your children better than you do. I don't know, that irks me. We've all made mistakes. The people who said so, let's take those poor little children out of the north part of Ontario and let's bring them to Duck Lake, Saskatchewan, away from their mom and dad. Let's do that because we want them to learn English. We want them to give up those tribal things. Let's do that. Beware the people who want to use the state for their own means. Protect the family, even if you don't agree with the family. We all don't agree on everything. But I say look out for state power. And yes, these organizations get state money. I pay taxes. They pay taxes. Who are we going to divide now is to the taxes up? We did that before. I don't think we want to start again.
It's not people from the outside forcing this. It's people within the community, the students themselves asking for
a bus. Oh, I don't disagree with having a club.
So
I say the operationalization of it. That's my concern.
Wow, you know, I'm going to have to say sorry, but we're really out of time, and I know I don't like to keep people beyond the time we've got to, so if you wouldn't mind just maybe asking the speakers directly your question, I'm sorry to cut you off, but I just want to, first of all, thank our speakers for just being so darn prepared and ready with their very controversial and different ideas, and I can probably speak for everyone here, really appreciate the time that you both took to prepare your talks and to be controversial and to disagree with one another, because these are very, very controversial, difficult issues that we are dealing with. So thank you so much, both of you. Can I get a round of applause for you?